Welcome everybody to our webinar on preparing citizens for an inclusive digitized society. I'm Leen Downs, Professor of Communication Science at the Institute for Media Studies of KU Leuven in Belgium, and I'll be hosting this ySKILLS webinar today. I'm very proud to welcome four international experts who will present their views in short 7 to 8 minute presentations. And after this, they will enter into a discussion led by our fifth expert, who is also the lead author of the first report released in the framework of our ySKILLS projects just a few months ago. This project seeks to contribute to a deeper knowledge on the digital skills that young people need in the 21st century and about the role of digital skills education. And you have a slide here where the important messages to take away from this report are just mentioned. And I'll just read them out loud. The current quality and effectiveness of initiatives intended to build digital skills are often deficient and inconsistent. The provision varies greatly within and across European countries. And the crucial question is how to improve this provision. The development of digital skills and the promotion of digital literacy is not a task that only concerns the formal educational system. For the entire report, I refer to our website, yskills.eu. We will also take questions from the chat box, so please share your questions with us so that we can deal with a selection of them in the Q&A session and bring them up to the virtual table in the half an hour debate among our experts after the presentations. After each one, I'll ask a short question to the presenters, allowing the next speaker to get ready for his presentation. The ySKILLS report I just referred to is based on interviews with 34 experts in education and from the labor market, originating from 6 European countries: Estonia, Finland, Germany, Italy, Poland, and Portugal. The experts who will speak today contributed to that report and come from different countries in Europe and from different areas of expertise: the European labor market, education policy with a focus on innovation, teacher education, and digital industry. They will reflect on what solutions they see for a more coordinated policy on media and digital literacy in their countries and in Europe. We ask them the following challenging question: how can the current fragmented approach in the member states when it comes to digital literacy policy be turned into a more efficient and a more sustainable policy framework that takes into account individual vulnerabilities as well as a more longitudinal, more lifespan perspective? So the purpose of the webinar today is to present tentative solutions, some best practices, and some recommendations. Before getting started, a few words only about the ySKILLS project itself. It's a European research project funded by the European Commission, which seeks to better understand which skills 12 to 17 year olds must obtain to knowingly and critically use information communication technologies for their well-being, for their education, and in their social lives. And also to improve our knowledge on how young people can build resistance, can build resilience against possible negative impacts. We also look at children in a vulnerable situation in Europe. And in this COVID crisis, we've seen the widening gaps between the haves and the have-nots, and have come across forgotten or even neglected digital gaps in terms of the mere physical access to digital technologies of young people in Europe, for instance, in the home context. Looking at the labor market trends worldwide, a major shift in the types of skills needed is taking place, and young people need to be prepared to face these challenges. Interestingly, although recent Eurostat data show a slight increase in the percentage of individuals who report possessing digital skills above a basic level, 27% in 2015 compared to 31% last year, there's also a rise in individuals with low overall digital skills, 23% in 2015 compared to 29% in 2019. So discrepancies are growing. Preparing Europe for the increasing importance of digital technologies remains a priority for the European Commission. The Commission's strategy for the digital future of Europe pursues three key objectives: technology that works for people, a fair and competitive digital economy, an open, democratic, and sustainable society. And it is in this context that digital skills play a crucial role, both for the personal development of people, the economic future of Europe, for which a digitally skilled workforce will be a decisive factor. Talking about the labor force, let me now introduce our first speaker, who is Mr. Antonio, José Antonio Vieira da Silva, who is the executive director of the Res Publica Foundation and currently a special advisor to European Commissioner for Jobs and Social Rights, Nicolas Schmidt. Mr. da Silva graduated in economics in Instituto Superior de Economia in Lisbon, and previously he was a minister of labor, solidarity, and social security, several terms, and of economy and innovation until 2011. He was also a member of the Portuguese Parliament until 2015. Mr. da Silva, you're very welcome to start your presentation.
Thank you very much. Good morning for all. I hope you are seeing me well. I can use my 7-8 minutes emphasizing 3 or 4 main points. First of all, answering your first question. Have we problems, still problems, when we are talking of public policy in order to improve digital skills in Europe? And of course, the answer is not difficult. Yes, we have severe problems. And I think the main problems are linked to differences between generations. And this is a key question for our labor market. And I'm talking more from the labor market issues than from the education issues. And second, we have problems, and in my country they are growing, problems of gender differences. The second question, it will be possible to replace some kind of fragmentation in our policies from fragmentation to a joint approach? Well, I think it is not easy, because yes, it's true, we have in many countries and in European Union fragmentation education or labor policies, but the main reason is that because the reality has strong fragmentations. For instance, our labor market is a very fragmented labor market. So it's not easy to build, for instance, training policies based on digital skills when you are facing severe differences in our labor market. And for instance, in the way the young people enter in the labor market. So we need to find a solution. We don't have a silver bullet to solve that kind of fragmentation. But I think, this is my third point, we can build an approach that more and more link the different players and the different problems of our society when we are talking about digital challenges. In my country, in Portugal, we are developing a network of centers that have a combined management from education and labor, is a common approach. We are building a network of centers with the participation of social partners, of trade unions, employers, companies, schools, and employment services. And in that kind of centers, the people, mainly the young people with lacks of in their primary or secondary education, are going to find a way to build a different professional skills where the digital skills have a basic role. And that kind of centers, and that is another question you could, that kind of centers are very useful for people that have non-formal skills that they want to be recognized. And with a little help from those, the people, the trainers and the people that are in charge of those centers, they can combine the non-formal skills with a more formal education or training. So I think that still, when we are talking about the labor market, the lifelong learning is the main question, is a key question for everybody. And it perhaps useful to look the experience of people like myself that came from a non-digital world to a digital world. How can we solve the challenges we had in the past? And I think the main question is to change, to look the digital challenge not like a mountain to climb, but a tool to help us. When we achieve that kind of change, we solve the major problems of the digital skills.
Thanks a lot for your presentation. And I'll go now, without further ado, to our second presenter, who is Donatella Solda. And she co-founded Wonderful Education, which is a startup fostering education and innovation. She is director of Future Education Modena, which is the first EdTech hub in Italy. She has worked in the cabinet of three ministers of education in Italy, and she has developed and supported several policies on innovation and digital transformations. She co-authored the National Digital School Plan for Italy, has been also a professor of copyright and comparative private law at University of Bari, teaching associate of European law at Oxford Brookes University and of fundamental rights in Warsaw at the Lazarski University. Donatella, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me and thank you for this great opportunity. The question that we've been discussing, that we are discussing today, is of course very timely, and it has been so since some time. I would like to share a couple of slides that would help the presentation of what I'm going to tell you. It will be a presentation of what we've been doing in Italy in the recent years, and what I've been participating in Italy about that. The occasion today is a great moment to speak about challenges, which are very well known to all of us and are there since some time. We know about the skill mismatch issue that most of our countries are facing. We know that education needs to be relevant to society and needs to adopt solutions that will work to create citizens and workers, not only workers but also citizens, able to understand society around them. And we know that technological change is going to a path creating some pedagogical, both innovation and challenges. So I will share with you a couple of examples of what I've been doing while at the ministry in the period from 2012 and 2018, and then what I'm doing now with our R&D, so applied research in relation to education and technologies. We've been discussing, a lot of us are discussing about comprehensive policies and structural policies that would address the issue of coordination between ministries and between different stakeholders in society. Most of the times we know that ministries work in silos, so they have their own stakeholders and they of course have the commitment to respond to their stakeholders and don't really find either time or the occasion to coordinate with other policies. I've been lucky enough to be working in a moment of great reforms in Italy. In 2015, we've been investing a lot, and this is, even if it's a policy within the Ministry of Education, we managed to, and I will show you how, to engage with stakeholders outside the Ministry of Education, both at the government level and at the, let's say, societal level. Here you will see a framework policy that we adopted for digital skills. It was a 5 years plan with a big investment and with several key actions that would enable certain changes in a way innovation would be perceived at the level of schools. The main action was to identify a key role, an innovation manager within teachers, not a technical figure, but a teacher who would then promote and coordinate innovation actions. And who would then speak with the world around schools, a world being the municipality or stakeholders around the subject of digital innovation. Two other policies are an example of what we've been doing at that time. We've been promoting the concept of stakeholders, engagement and coalitions, for example, on two subjects. One was related to media information literacy, so we've been creating a coalition for digital citizenship, mapping stakeholders who were already offering programs, contents, and actions in relation to a syllabus that centrally was drafted. So we drafted the goals of the education experiences, and we mapped stakeholders from the whole society of very different variety of stakeholders, from NGOs, commercial actors, institutional actors. And we've been doing that for digital citizenship and for entrepreneurship education. So this was a way for us to tell teachers and schools and students that the world exists around their schools, that schools have the opportunity to interact with the world around them. What we've been doing after that in 2018, I'm speaking in plural because I work together with a partner in crime, let's say, we've been funding what's globally is known under the name of EdTech, an EdTech hub. So we realized while we were the central government that there was something missing. We had always the perception that there was the need to bridge solutions for the education system with the work, the great work that the research system was doing. And both on the moment of creation of products and on the moment of measuring impact and effectiveness of educational solutions. So we created a model a very research intensive production model that embeds the work of schools, the iteration and prototypation with schools and with stakeholders in the creation of contents. So our model, our view on education, new educational solutions are to embed in the first place of the production of educational solutions, both state-of-the-art findings of research and research practices. As we, maybe because we are researchers by nature, so we believe that education needs qualitative impact descriptors and not only quantitative, because we understand that the educational process is a matter of impact and effectiveness, which is extremely hard to measure, but extremely relevant to map. So we involve stakeholders, recipients of our process, our production, in the whole process of iteration, identification of the needs, of the actual needs of teachers and students, and of the commercial sector. So just to avoid the mismatch of subjects promoted, even, you know, fashionable subjects or very timely subjects that one would understand, like coding, logical computational thinking and all that, that seems like a very actual subject, but maybe needs to have a fine tuning with the state of the art research findings and actual needs of the commercial sector. So our system is based on the concept of testbed network. So our recipients are the involved in the whole process of experiences building. And we do that on extremely wide range of subjects, both methodological and disciplinary subjects. We do that in a way that we try to tackle needs of everyday needs for curricular teaching. So we believe that digital skills should not be an extra hours activity, but for instance, we promote Italian or mathematical experiences which use, for instance, computational linguistics or computational design to embed, to innovate methodologies. So digital skills are horizontal to disciplinary activities. As I said, the challenges are known, the skill mismatch, the relevance, and the fast changing path of technological evolution. What could be an opportunity or a solution for that can be summed up in, I would propose three key points. First point is to create programs, experiences, projects, educational projects on a variety of subjects in a way that research findings on cognitive and learning sciences are embedded, always embedded, taken into account how the brain work, how the learning process is changed in environments augmented by technologies, so that we exploit the investment done on the research sector into the education sector. It looks like a very basic request, but most of the times we see this is not always happening. And that we embed in investment in education quality demonstrators, not only quantitative, quality demonstrator of impact and effectiveness, so that to demonstrate the relevance of actions. How to do that? the goal is to enhance quality and quantity of the innovation offer in education. We know that technology is present in K-12 and educational environments, but most of the time I have to recognize that it's not an aware choice. It's a choice, it's an opportunity that is grasped because it's there, and without a full understanding of what are the consequences of introducing technologies in the learning process. And to do that, one solution that we propose is that both centers like ours, we are a very atypical center because we are also non-profit, both for profit and for non-profit center, is to work together with the recipients, to iterate, to look at educational processes as they were drugs from the pharmaceutical sector, so that stakeholders, students and teachers are involved as testers for longer periods of the final outcome. So that's the awareness, so that we create awareness and quality demand for innovation, so that teachers would understand what is a quality learning experience and not just take whatever the market is proposing them for technological contingencies.
And I was just wondering, if you look at the Italian situation and you were focusing on the figure of the teacher, is the centrality of the teacher one of the success factors for Italy? And is that something that certainly in other countries we could learn from? It would be also a nice transition to the next speaker, actually, who is the expert in teacher education.
The centrality of teachers in Italy is both a strong point and a weakness of the system, as for several years we've been unfortunately disinvesting in the education sector. So the career of teachers was not central to education policies. Teachers' training was not central. Assessments, a sort of assessment, was not there. There were no competition, there were no checks and it was not a serious process of induction. So unfortunately, the numbers of teachers are huge in Italy. We are around a million people, 750,000 on a permanent basis, and then some other 100,000 for temporary contracts. And the quality and the investment of them on them has been interrupted for over two decades. Luckily, recently, since 2015, we've been lucky enough to have a reform of the school sector. For instance, one of the main tools used for self-training is a budget that each teacher has of €500 per year, and they spend it on their own training in addition to other occasions. So I think that indeed the role of teachers is central, but the role of government is to invest in them, both in their training and in the assessment of their needs. So, yes, it's central.
Thank you very much. Interesting that they get an individual budget for their training. Yes. So, yeah, teacher training is very important, and that's, of course, the area of expertise of our next presenter, Professor Ari Myllyviita from the University of Helsinki. He's a lecturer of chemistry and mathematics, but also a teacher educator. He's active in the international research and development community for teacher education. He's a researcher and a developer in PIRE, which is a project for developing science education, a cooperation between Michigan State University and the University of Helsinki. Professor Myllyviita, the floor is yours.
Thank you. It's pleasure to be here and make some impact on this webinar or in this discussion. I will share my slides, so let's start immediately with those. So So here is slides and some picture. It's from Johannesburg. I was working with the University of Johannesburg also a few months totally. So that's why the picture is from Johannesburg. So I'm going to focus on teacher education totally, not just answering the question, trying to make an impact on that idea, on that theme, what we are discussing about. We know that what the basics of 21st century skills, and here's a version of 21st century pedagogy. I have highlighted some points what I'm going to focus on, and not going through all those things what you can see from this slide. So one big problem is that our educational systems, and of course also Finnish education system, is sometimes just focusing one kind of education, one kind of teaching. And we have to see that all those students, all the pupils are different. And that's why we have to consider that also teachers have to have different kind of skills, because the kids are different. So fortunately, ICT and social media gives us a lot of opportunities and possibilities to focus in different kind of groups of children and different kind of children in classrooms. So we have now opportunity to increase and develop our teaching also. So about this focus on teacher education, of course I have to say that I'm quite ICT orientated teacher educator, and I'm trying to focus how to enable technologies, how teachers, future teachers can use and why they are using new technology and social media in teaching. And normally it's so, of course we can study different kind of programs, but my idea is that we try to focus on using them, of course, during teacher education, to make them as a everyday tool. So then they can, when they are planning their own teaching, they of course have a background that of course I'm using ICT, I use social media and these kind of tools all the time. And how to make it this possible, we need to teach our teachers, future teachers, how to use ICT, how to use collaborative mediums, how to use different kind of digital tools. I have used these letters. I can combine almost everything I have taught and I'm teaching to my teacher, student teachers. 4 C's: create, customize, create, collaborate. You can say that there is a whole content of the future education. Of course, then you have to also focus on sharing, and you have to teach teachers to share their ideas, to share their materials, to share their teaching methods, because we are creating new kind of pedagogy. It's not just we are lifting the traditional pedagogy to new level or the other room where we are using then ICT and social media. We have to create new pedagogy. And of course that means that we have to create new kind of teacher educator pedagogy also. then openness, for example, it's a question about materials. They have to be open and they have to be free. And that's always a problem when we are discussing about different kind of materials done by certain companies who are willing to collect money off from them. But when teachers are working together, they are sharing and they are opening their own materials for others, and they are trying to share them in a free basis. Of course, then when we are talking about sharing and openness, we have to have a trust, and this is the Finnish way to make teachers' quality, is that we trust on teachers, and then through that trust, we of course say that when we are sharing and when we are opening our classrooms to other people and the other teachers, we trust on each other. But here you can say, of course, those terms, great. We are all the time, we have to make comparisons between different materials. We can't do that by ourselves. We have to do it in groups, and teachers need to cooperate and collaborate in this matter. And when we are talking about digital skills at all, it's all the time we have to create new things, new ways, new approaches. And that makes, of course, the future quite interesting in teacher education and teaching, because we have to create all the time new things and test. And that's why we have to have a lot of research also to show and get some evidence what is the best way to teach and study. To customize, we need to have an opportunity to customize everything. For example, if you have books or teaching materials, you have to customize them for yourself according to your own teaching paradigm or teaching approach. But here is a quite important letters for us. When we are talking about education and where we are using these different kind of digital tools, I always make these kind of classifications. I speak about pedagogical tools, for example, for modeling, simulation, concepts, and so on. Then we are talking about cognitive tools, how to support studying, how we make documenting as a tool and supporting our pedagogical tools. How we are using our virtual learning environments to support study. Then we have this third dimension, metacognitive tools, how we arrange reflection, how we use ICT and social media to create possibilities to reflect yourself, make self-assessment, of course, at all to have any kind of assessment, you need some tools, and you can use many kind of tools. In our country, we are now talking about how to use this educational big data to support teaching and assessment. Very big question is about how teachers work together, how they cooperate. And we have learned and we have studied quite a lot about how to use this community of practice approach between teachers. We know that the COP approach you have to have a domain of knowledge. For example, in my case, it's chemistry education. We need that community, and we need a tool to in daily basis to have these kind of communities. For example, we have a very active Facebook groups for different kind of teacher groups. Then the practice, we have common issues, problems, and we share our knowledge through that community tools, what we have created for us. But I have had very good results when we have discussed and made some research about how our community of practices works. But that is this key issue when we are talking about future teacher education. Then we have big question is about how we arrange e-mentoring. It's not just a mentoring, but how we use and how we take ICT and social media tools account so we can help our mentoring processes in our schools or in our teacher education. Here's a one example how we have arranged it in Finland in prayer service, teacher education in the induction phase and in after teacher education in when you are in service situation and you are already doing your teaching job. Here's one point if you will focus on this reflection question. Here's a revised version of Shen's idea, how this reflection goes on prayer service teacher education. And this is what we are doing here. And I'm quite certain that using ICT helps us quite a lot in this question. Here's one example. We made a mentoring program in the University of Johannesburg from South Africa. And you can see this is a free course and a free material. You can see what kind of approach we are having here in Finland and in UJ in South Africa. I mentioned these materials. One fun thing is about how we use different kind of electronic books. And I have also wondered what is the future, what are the steps to editable books, and what is the process when we are changing our materials from traditional web pages or traditional printed materials to editable ebooks. And this is one I think it's a future question also, how we create and how we share our materials and how we make those different kind of materials editable so every teacher could change the format or change the content or arrange the content in a new way so that those materials fits their own teaching ideas and teaching paradigms. Here's one example, the future of our education, for example, in chemistry education, these 3D modeling programs make us much more efficient, and we can use visualization and modeling in a very practical and innovative way. This was the last slide, was this idea about how we use ICT in chemistry education, how we use these modeling programs. So thank you.
It's very interesting. Actually, Finland was a great example in the report. I'm going to keep my question and put it in the chat box because we have to move on to Professor Jürgen Zeitz, who is our fourth expert professor of marketing, media and digital industries at Stuttgart Media University. And he's one of the leading digital marketing experts in Germany. He's passionate about data-driven, creative and engaging digital marketing communication. And he helped build and scale up several successful digital companies as a managing director, as a founding partner, or a member of the board. He worked, for instance, for Microsoft, for web.de, and if I'm correct, this is Germany's second, I think, internet portal, and a 1&1 also, which is a web hosting company. So he's going to talk about how he facilitated non-profit organizations in using their digital channels for their causes, among other things. Jürgen, the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you for the introduction. Thanks for having me. I think some people in the webinar will think, oh, what is this guy doing here with the skills thing? But I think I have an interesting story to tell based on the research I've done within the last few years. And I'm actually coming from a very, very business-driven perspective. I did research on digital value creation. And digital value creation with the focus on generating value on a private equity based idea. So the idea, how can you drive EBITDA? How can you drive revenue? How can you improve the valuation of the company overall? And in this research, we talked to at least 50 CDOs from major companies in mainly Germany, some European players as well. In this research, we found something very interesting. Because we asked them, what are the initiatives that create most value for you? What are your core initiatives regarding value creation? And we offered them, based on some previous research, the possibility to develop new digital business model, all the digital marketing and sales strategy stuff, digital business operations, so becoming more effective, a focus that is very much seen in the German Mittelstand, where a lot of digitization initiatives are focused on driving their operations in an even smoother way. And we had a fourth thing, and that was the digital mind and skill set. So developing employees. And what we initially thought, what was our assumption, is that this will be low on the ranking of these CDOs because they're very business driven. And we found exactly the opposite. So what we found is that these CDOs talked to us and said, all right, it's the most important thing for us to be successful are the digital skills of our employees. We have a huge problem there. We have a huge skill problem there. And we want to empower the workforce. And we don't see it as something that is more in the HR department. It's really value creation for us. This brought us deeper into the topic of the whole skill sets. I then had some students, PhD students and some master students working more on what are digital skills that these people see. So what do business people see as digital skills and what are important things they want to look at? And where we found out that in this area of digital skills, a lot of the things that people see as digital skills are in the area of social skills and also of self-management skills. So it is, of course, the data literacy. It is, of course, the methodologies, the design thinking, the analytics, the problem solving. But they see a lot of issues regarding digital. How are people resilient? How do we keep our people to be focused? What is with the willingness to change because there is so much happening? And this was very, very high on the agenda. And this is the report why I actually, or I likely think I never asked, but why I ended up in the ySKILLS program, because we published a report there. But from a business perspective, these things are of huge importance to CDOs who want to drive value. So it's not just for social things, it's really to drive value. That's the one interesting thing I want to add today. And the second interesting thing, and that's just a thought, because we later on thought on how to change the whole thing. And we found something very we found bad policy here, because in a lot of these schemes that are supporting skills, exactly the skills that are most needed are not funded. So you can get funding, for example, from the German government for all kinds of development of your people. But as soon as there's something personal in there, like resilience or like focus training, they say, this is a private thing. So they say, oh, and we cannot pay for this. The companies are now willing to do that, but the German government, they are not doing it. So I'm advocating for a change there to make personal skills something that is also fundable by European and especially the German government, European initiative. These are my thoughts. I'm looking forward to the discussion.
Okay, fantastic, great. So actually then, without further ado, I would like to invite Veronica Donoso, who is our independent consultant specialized in children and digital technologies and online safety, and also, of course, the lead author of the report we're all referred to this morning. She is a colleague of mine in the Institute for Media Studies at KU Leuven, and through her career, she has collaborated with several organizations like the United Nations, European Commission, and European Schoolnet, and European Schoolnet, through that connection, she's in the ySKILLS project. Before her being a consultant, she was the executive director of InHope, and this is the leading global network combating online child sexual abuse material. So I think now we open the debate, and Veronica is going to lead this.
Thank you very much, Len, and thank you everybody for attending this webinar. I'm very happy also on a personal level because, as Len said, I was one of the authors of the first ySKILLS report, and we worked with different people from the ySKILLS Consortium to select experts from education and from the labor market. And it's an unusual combination. To bring policymakers, to bring people working with the industry, because it's usually when we talk about media, digital literacy, information literacy, what we see is many different sectors involved. We see the public, the private, we see formal education, informal education, we also see the training sector, the labor market. So we see interest from all sides to have people with a higher, with better digital skills to be able to cope, to be able to function in society. But we also see, and we also saw in our report, that many experts were saying that the efforts are not enough, and we see a lot of effort put on the formal education system, but what happens when people leave schools? And I think one of the first questions that I wanted to ask the experts, and it's also because these were questions that we were asked when we were making the interviews, is actually lots of efforts in all countries to foster media digital literacy. But most of these efforts seem to begin and end at school. One of the big problems is that obviously schools offer different quality of education, and access and quality of education is actually quite diverse across countries, but also within many countries. So that's one point. So access and quality of education is not equal, but also technologies evolve very fast. And obviously, as the experts have said today, the skill sets required to remain competent, to remain able to succeed and use the digital skills in adequate ways and proactive ways, then you also need to upgrade these skills constantly beyond school. So for question for all the experts to reflect, what is needed to bring a stronger lifelong perspective to digital literacy education? And from your experiences, what can be done, for instance, especially in the case of Jürgen, after school, how can companies then support these efforts, and the other speakers, what are your countries doing from education, for instance? So the floor is yours.
So as you asked me directly for the afterwards, I just start with the discussion. So what we see is that communicating the value of the creation towards the business, so not just seeing as a need you have to keep your employees, to keep them happy, but really to show how the impact on the business is. This will be key, because especially in these times, people are focusing on key initiatives. We saw that now people scaled down a little bit on their training efforts. So it's not just that they went digital, but they also scaled down their training efforts. We always see this if there's an economical downturn. And now it's core with the companies to, first of all, communicate how much value they get out of them. Not their employees get of them, but the companies. So we should not be afraid of exactly researching that and also communicating that, because that's a lot of people are afraid of that and say, no, it's not a topic, we should not talk about money, but that's how we can get more companies to invest more in that. And the second, of course, is what I already said, is supporting these efforts within the companies. We are spending now a lot of money on different issues, but I haven't seen anything that says, all right, now is the time to support education in companies especially. And I think it would be a good idea to pump some money into the companies, but also do something good. Yeah.
No, great. Thank you. That's a very different perspective. I know, like, people from education, researchers are not used to talking about bringing value, bringing the money. But I think you bring an excellent point. I mean, and Donatella, maybe, and would you like to add something? Because I see you next in my screen.
Yes. Well. On the point of how to make it relevant, how to liaise what happens in schools with the reality around schools. Of course, this is something, a challenge that all teachers and all schools have, because of course they need to commit on the national syllabus, on the national indicators, and they need to achieve certain standards of disciplinary knowledge or skills, and sometimes this leads to forgetting that there's a world outside. So we know, of course, that methodologies are in place for educational experiences which are based on reality and challenge, reality checks, reality based cases, and this is a modern way of teaching. We understand that educational practice is going there. Another thing is to embed experiences which are, sometimes they are referred to as vocational training, visits of students to the outside world. The balance is different. I wouldn't say there's a unique solution or on what is best, whether to have third parties going to the and visit external experiences, but the alignment between what it's done in schools and what is the demand of society and the working sector. I speak from experience, being at the ministry level, at the central government level, to curve, to change how this a huge system with 9 million students, I'm speaking about the Italian case, and 1 million teachers are doing everyday practice, is something that requires time. It cannot be done from one day to the other, of course. It can't be like this. It's a big ship that you need to change in direction. At the same time, the society is nowadays changing in a fast way, faster than before. So maybe it's not the case to invest energies in going after the changes, the contingency of current demands, but of course to have a long sight and to try to have dynamics that makes makes it possible to be aware of what happens outside. So the future of work, the future skills balanced with deep knowledge of disciplinary basic skills maybe is a solution. And when Jürgen was mentioning about leaders and entrepreneurs and what is the perfect skills, I understand it's a very difficult, it's a tricky thing to achieve. A reality check is always a solution. So flexibility in a way teachers are committing in achieving the national curriculum, so giving them flexibility in that, maybe it's a solution. I understand there's no single option for that.
So yeah, thank you Donatella, and thank you both. There are some questions on the chat, and one question is there is a distinction between age levels. Do you think there is a distinction between age levels for soft skills? Jürgen was talking before about, for instance, that for business people, skills like social skills are also relevant, or self-management. Irene's presentation talking about other types of skills that are necessary, for instance, in the case of teachers, not just to develop more a cognitive aspect, problem solving. So, and here we get a question about soft skills. And so what would be like this different in this sense? They said it would be interesting to learn the age parameters for soft skills and how they vary. So do you think that there are different ages to teach, to develop different types of soft skills? And what age should they start being taught? How can you promote also the development of soft? So maybe, for instance, Ari, do you see that when you teach, when you work with teachers? I mean, is there attention to soft skills, and how do you promote them?
We have arranged in our teacher training school, it's so that we have created a certain kind of steps. What are the skills you need to have when you are in a first or second level or upper? And of course, from a teacher education point of view, we also have created steps what teachers has to study and what they have to have, what kind of skills they have to have. And I think it's when we started to change, of course we have changed our curriculums. We are not fond of those standardized tests. They are from evil. We have tried to make it so that we increase and put a lot of money on teacher education for in-service teachers. We can talk about further education or lifelong learning and so on. But if you want to make any changes in schools, in teaching, we have to further educate teachers. And then you can expect that there will be any changes in at schools. Normally, if you don't do that, our teachers follow the previous approaches and previous teachings and the previous ways to do what they have done before. And that's I think one big problem is that how we change teachers' attitudes, how we give them a possibility to change their education, how we make them research or somehow develop themselves first, and then develop and change their education and then teaching. And I think it's a quite crucial question. It's about how we change our teacher education, and of course how we change our curriculum so that they are not so tight and not so focused on a certain old time and traditional skills. We just need today that we have to use ICT, we have to handle things with social media and so on.
Yeah, no, thank you. I think there you connect also to what Donatella, what Jürgen are saying, like flexibility seems to be like a very important feature, but the educational system seems to be very traditional, very conservative. That's also one of the criticisms, like many of you made during the report, that the educational systems are very conservative, and when it comes to innovation, they are not innovative enough. So it's very difficult to teach teachers to be flexible, while at the end of the year they need to comply with a number of requirements and fixed forms of assessment many times. So sometimes for teachers it seems difficult also to innovate. So, Jose, sorry, you wanted to say something. Yes, please go ahead.
I think there are two different but combined issues that we need to emphasize. First of all, about schools, about learning in schools, about teacher, students, and community, and economic players, and so on. Well, I think that is a crucial question. Because during many years, our education system in general, someone better, someone worse, tried to put all the money by teaching the people to do the same thing better and better, faster and faster. And that is not now, we are changing the global picture at the economic level. Of course, we need to do the things well in a factory, in a company, but there are new skills that the entrepreneur, that the companies, that the employers seek, and the new skills are how to solve problems, how to learn to learn. And that link between schools and companies and economy, it will be more and more important. But in my opinion, we are not going to solve the problem in a simple way. There always be a difference between what a student can learn in school. The better the school is, the more the school is linked to the community, there will be always a difference when the students go out from school and go to a company, to a big company, a small company, a startup. So there, the question of lifelong learning is crucial. And lifelong learning is not a problem for people with 50 or 45. It's a problem for people after 5 years, sometimes 3 years after they go out from school. And I think that the question remains the same. We need to have training. We need to have lifelong learning linked to the things that the people are doing in the sector, in the company they choose, in the opportunity they have, but always with the digital skills as a base to solve the problems, because they are present in all branches of our economy, modern economy. So I think it's very important that we find, and I think it's very difficult to find good examples in Europe to choose the better way to organize that kind of lifelong learning for everybody, not for only for the people that don't have the opportunity to learn the digital skills when they were in school, but also for the people that go out from schools and in the companies, in the business, they face problems they are not prepared to solve. And
Of course, return to school, or in other ways, breaking the frontiers, the borders between schools and economy, it will be very important. But there are another world to explore, another tools to improve, and tools in many cases linked to the capacity of each people develop their own skills. And that is, as already as said, is more and more emphasized as important by entrepreneurs, by companies, by employers. The capacity of people to solve their own problems. For finish, the role of the public authorities at local, regional, national level, in order to empower the people in this kind of skills, is very important. Let me give you an example from my own country. 2 years ago, we launched a tool, a simulator of pension. Everybody can go to the website of the Social Security and have a tool that, based on their own career, the figures, the wages they have during the last years, all the years in that case, they can estimate how, when the people can go to the retirement, what will be the value of the pension, and the people can introduce options, different options. If I work more 2 years, what will be the difference in my pension? That kind of tools, after 1 year, more than 1 million of people in Portugal have used that kind of that facility. And that it is a way to improve and to show the importance for everyone to have a capacity to deal with this kind of skills.
Thank you so much. I think that it's a good reflection that education needs to be connected not just to the labor market, but also to community life and to what happens, I mean, to what matters to your life afterwards. And many times I have the feeling that there is like a big discrepancy between also we see now with the views of what are digital skills basically for different sectors and for different actors. I think that's a big question, and I'm happy that you are like being honest and reflecting from where you are coming from, because one of the questions from the panel actually was, what are the most important, in your views, what are the most important digital skills that children and adolescents should develop? And I don't know, Len, if we have time to ask them, maybe a last reflection could be like the last minute one, but really not more than a minute each. Could you tell me what would be the most important digital skills you think that we should support children and adolescents to develop?
Today, during this corona time, I have to say that social connections, how to use and create social connections via internet. So cooperation skills are in a huge place today. Of course, you have to have skills to use the computer, but the social skills are quite important today to make the future of education and make the real life working today, because you have to use computers and internet to do it.
My opinion is that kids are immersed in the internet environments. So my understanding is that they are a skills that they need to develop is to understand how internet infrastructures work, so that they are aware of their behavior and the interaction that they develop in those environments are in their control not in the control of the platform that they are using. I see that awareness of how algorithms and how platforms induce and nudge them into certain behaviors are central for them to be active and aware citizens also in the online world.
We see our children are not my main expertise, but we see the creative problem solving as a key thing, and everything that helps to this creative problem solving would be something that is very helpful to support them in their focus to work on everything that is helping them to find novel and creative solutions.
I think the main question is how to help young people to find the information they need and to be critical about the sources of that information. It's not an easy task, but it is a crucial one, because we have all an ocean of information above us, and it's not easy to find for young people to find the real value of the different information we have. Help young people to choose, to find the information first of all, and after all to choose the information that is really important for their choices. For me, the key question.
Thank you so much, Lynn. The floor.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you all. I think our time is up. People have to go to other places. So thank you very much for this insightful discussion. Clearly, the successful development of digital skills and the relevant policy requires the involvement of all. The teachers, of course, also the citizens from young to old, but employees and governments and also the private sector. And it's exactly that working together, this connectedness that is so important, and to have this role in a responsive way, to play it in a responsive and a responsible way. So thank you very much for all your examples from your different countries. We will continue to work in ySKILLS on the measurement of the different skills, with a focus on also the softer skills, not only the technical skills. So please keep yourselves updated. We will send you our findings and messages on our findings in certainly other webinars to come. Follow us if you wish on our platforms in Twitter and on Facebook for updates. So thank you again. Take care and enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you.